Hey, LifePoint, I hope that you guys are having an incredible day today. If you're a guest with us, I want to welcome you. My name is Jeff. I'm the pastor here at LifePoint, and it's an honor having you with us. And we are in a series of messages called Magna Carta, and we're going to be in part five. We're going to get there in just a little bit, but we got some great stuff coming up that I want to tell you about. This is the time of year that we begin preparing as a church for what God has ahead of us. This time of year, we prep for a special year-end Christmas offering. And throughout the past years, we've been able to give in a generous way as a church to initiatives all over the world, as well as right here in our own neighborhood. We've been able to do things like drill wells in Africa. We built a church in Uganda. We've expanded and paid off our own kid space right here at LifePoint Church. And many of you were the driving force behind that. You prayed, you gave, you sacrificed. And I just want to say thank you so much for what you have done. And I just believe, looking back at what our church has accomplished, it fires me up for what God has ahead of us. You know, in the Bible, in Acts chapter 1, the very last words of Jesus to his disciples were that you are going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. What he was saying to them was that your next steps are going to take you to new places. You're going to go literally to the ends of the earth, and you're going to carry the message of hope. Well, I'm excited to tell you that we are preparing for what we are calling our next steps offering. Our next steps offering. On December the 6th, we're asking everybody that calls LifePoint home to begin praying, to begin seeking God, and to come prepared on December 6th to give an offering to help us take our next step. But it's not just about LifePoint Church. It's about what God is doing across the globe. You see, as our church has grown, God has knit our heart with several ministries that we're excited to be partnering with. You know, if Jesus sent his disciples to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth, that's like saying, I want you to make an impact locally, nationally, and globally. Well, we've got a global partner that we are incredibly excited about, and it's Amigos for Christ. Many of you are familiar with Amigos for Christ. They're located in Nicaragua. As a matter of fact, we've already seen 150 LifePointers go on a missions trip to Nicaragua. And I know that when you go there, God changes your life in a radical way. One of the villages in Nicaragua that we've been able to partner with is called La Chuscada. La Chuscada is a village that has been through incredible difficulty. But because of Amigos and because of the generosity and partnership with LifePoint, they've been able to receive fresh water. Imagine living in a place where you had no clean water and now it is delivered all the way to your home. That's amazing. Well, the next hurdle that they're facing is education. 67% of the kids growing up in Nicaragua never make it past sixth grade. And because of that, they face incredible difficulties. And our church, in partnering with Amigos for Christ, has said, we're going to do something about that. We want to change a generation that is ultimately going to change the entire landscape of Nicaragua, beginning in this village called La Chuscada. And so we're going to make an impact. Part of our next steps offering is going to Amigos for Christ to build the school in La Chuscada. And what fires me up is they're not just building any old run-of-the-mill school. This is going to be the best school in all of Nicaragua. It is open to the public. Kids from surrounding communities are going to be able to come. And how awesome to just think, just maybe you could be on a missions trip in the next year or two. You could go to La Chuscada and you can meet the kids that you're going to be able to make an impact in. So globally, we're partnering with Amigos for Christ and we're going to continue to further the impact. The entire project cost $70,000. They've already raised $35,000. And I just believe that our church can make a big dent in the remaining $35,000. So be praying about that. On the national level, I'm really excited to tell you that we, as we've grown as a church, we've been able to begin impacting other churches. And one of the churches that we've been able to directly impact is some friends of ours in a tiny little town in Chillicothe, Ohio, called Center Point Church. Yes, I said Chillicothe. You're wondering where in the world is that? I wondered that too until I went to Chillicothe for the first time. God has built a friendship between my heart and the heart of Pastor Chris Van Buskirk. Now, many of you know Pastor Chris because he's been here. He's preached from the LifePoint stage. And what God is doing in Center Point Church is amazing. You see, they're just about 6 years old, and in 6 years, they've grown to over 600 people. They're meeting in a school. They're running three services. I mean, I have flashbacks to the days that we were in a school, and they're in the process of taking their next step. Pastor Chris just announced to their church that they're launching a No Limits campaign for them to be able to reach the 70% of Chillicothe that doesn't go to church anywhere, for them to be able to secure their first ever permanent facility. I don't know if you were a part of LifePoint back in those days when we took that step, but that was scary and that was faith stretching. And as we stand in it now, I realize that was one of the most pivotal moments of our church, and they're in the process of taking that. Well, I'm excited because I want our little brothers there in Chillicothe to know that Big Brother LifePoint believes in them. And here's something really cool. So while you're watching this today on video, I'm actually in Chillicothe at Centerpoint preaching at all three of their services. Now, you guys pray for me because I don't know if you know this. I'm a Steelers fan, and we lost to the Bengals last week, so I'm probably preaching angry right about now because we had a friendly bet that said I have to wear Bengals gear if the Steelers lose. So I probably have a Bengals hat on or a Bengals shirt, and I'm not happy about it, but I still love them. And so pray for me that I will be grace-filled when I don't want to be. But bottom line is, these guys are incredible. They're doing phenomenal things. I mean, they've seen God just go above and beyond over and again. Their team is poised to just transform the town of Chillicothe, and what God's going to do there is going to expand way beyond that. And so part of our next steps offering is going to help Centerpoint Church take their next step. And someday they're going to be in their facility and they're going to be saying, thank you, LifePoint Church, for believing in us. I remember when we were taking that step and I just wondered if there was anybody else out there that would believe in us. And you know what? Last year when our church was expanding our kid space, Centerpoint sent a check to us saying we want to be a part of what God is doing. Well, this is our chance to be able to say, Centerpoint, we believe in you. We love you. And so, LifePoint, as you're praying, pray for Centerpoint and Chillicothe and Pastor Chris Van Buskirk that God would do more than they could ever ask or imagine, and we're going to be a part of sowing into that. So globally, we're focused on Amigos for Christ in Nicaragua, La Chuscada. Nationally, Centerpoint Church in Ohio, and then locally, we're going to pour into Wilmington, North Carolina, and the surrounding regions. You know, when we started LifePoint Church, we had a dream of impacting Wilmington. I had no clue that what God was going to do here in Wilmington would reach beyond this city to surrounding areas. I had no idea that we would have people literally making a drive every single week from Leland, from Carolina Beach, from Burgaw, from Jacksonville, from Topsail, from Surf City. It's amazing when you stop and you realize that what God is doing here is so attractive and so transformational that people are driving 45 minutes to an hour just to get a taste of it. I mean, when you stop and look at this year alone, we have seen 301 people baptized. And that's not even counting what God's doing today at LifePoint Church. And so I ask you, LifePoint, would you partner and would you pray? Would you pray that as we give generously, sacrificially, above and beyond our tithes and offerings, that God will multiply it? And that as we take our next steps, as we step out, that we would see God step in a radical way, and it would transform this community, that we would see more people discovering the love of Christ. And so locally, right here, LifePoint Church, our city, our region. Nationally, Centerpoint Church, Chillicothe. And then globally, Nicaragua, Amigos for Christ, La Chuscada. It's going to be amazing. I can't wait to share with you what God does. But on December 6th, we're going to bring a gift. So be praying, sacrifice. Let's get ready for what God is going to do. Hey, I'll tell you what. Can we pray? Let's pray over what God's going to do through this special offering. But also, let's pray because God's got a word burning in my heart for this message today. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for who you are. Thank you for your gift. God, thank you that we are so incredibly blessed, but I know you blessed us to be a blessing. So Lord, I pray that you begin stirring in every heart, every family, every relationship. God, would you begin telling us, what can we do? How can we give? Knowing we can't ever outgive you, God, we want to take our next step so that we can see other people take their next step. God, because we know that when we step out, you step in, and when we take our next step, lives are changed. and we get to be a part of the process of seeing people become more like you. Father, I pray for this message today. I pray that your word would come alive. Lord, that you would set hearts free. And we ask that you would speak to us in a powerful way. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Magna Carta Part 5. Guys, I hope that you've been digging this series as much as I have. This book of the Bible, Galatians, has been a game changer in my life. And so I've been so fired up about this series. And matter of fact, I've been fired up about Galatians chapter 5. So today, I want you to get your Bibles out. If you got a Bible, get it out. If you've got a smartphone with a Bible app, pull it out, use it. If you don't own a Bible, like every week I tell you guys this, if you don't own a Bible, we want to give you one. So if this is your first time at LifePoint, we've got a gift for you. Stop out in the lobby, go by our next step, say, can I have a Bible? We'll give it to you. You can read this for yourself, but get your Bibles ready. Get your gray note cards out. We are going into my favorite chapter in all of the Bible. So Galatians is my favorite book. Chapter 5 is my favorite chapter. Verse 1 of chapter 5 is my favorite verse in my favorite chapter of my favorite book. And when I say it's my favorite, I mean like it has transformed my life, changed my life so much so that I actually have it tattooed on my body. So I get these questions a lot. I don't know if you ever realized this, but one of my arms looks different than the other. You see this? So my left arm has got a lot of tattoos. My right arm doesn't really, has one back here, but nobody really knows that. And so I get questions about my tattoos a lot. And the one that's obvious is right here. It's Galatians 5:1, my life verse, the very thing that's going to kick off this message. So get your Bibles out. Let's look at this together. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. 5:1 says this. Paul is writing to his friends in Galatia. These are new believers. These are non-believers. These are people being heavily swayed with the deception of legalism. These are people that are beginning to believe that their standing with God is determined on their performance in keeping the law. Paul's writing this letter. He's upset. He says, let me break it down for you. Here's the deal. Galatians 5, verse 1, he says this. He says, it is for freedom. Somebody say freedom. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Paul knows his audience. Paul understands that much of his audience are predominantly slaves. Politically, they're slaves. Culturally, spiritually, they're living as slaves. And the one common desire that every slave has is the longing to be free. Now, see, the challenge that we have when we look at this verse is we read this verse and we go, it's for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, blah, 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 blah. And we don't feel the weight of this verse the way that Paul's audience would have felt the weight of this verse. Because here's the deal. We live in a country that's free. We're allowed to gather. We're allowed to worship. We have freedom of speech. We have freedom. Like, we can't imagine life without freedom. And what I've come to discover is that we truly don't appreciate what we have until it's taken away. It's kind of like this. Moms and dads, here's a little assignment for you. Go home sometime this week and unplug the internet and watch what your kids do. They will freak out. I remember one time I was sitting at home, all of my kids were off in their room, and I said to Michelle, I said, watch this, and I unplugged the internet. And before I knew it, all my kids came out of their room, they came downstairs like there was a crisis on hand, they were like, where's the internet? What's something's wrong with the internet? I'm like, oh, I just unplugged it, I wanted to see you guys. You see, they began freaking out, and they don't know life without the internet. And now all of us old folks here, we know life without the internet. We know what dial-up was like. And could you imagine if kids today had to use dial-up internet? I mean, they would go nuts. But here's the thing. My kids didn't appreciate the internet until I took it away. And if some of you go home, you're going to have a battle on your hands, but you'll see this come to light. And so when we read this verse, so often we don't grasp the power behind these words. What they longed for was freedom. And this word freedom that Paul is using is a word that would have caused their ears to perk up. They would have leaned in because when he said this word freedom, it's the Greek word eleutheria. Eleutheria. All right, on three, I want everybody to say eleutheria. Ready? One, two, three, eleutheria. All right, halfway decent. This side, always better. This side, always a little weak. Bring your game. Bring your A game, all right? So one more time, eleutheria on three. One, two, three, eleutheria. Eleutheria is a word that meant a significant amount to these Greeks that were living as slaves. You see, a slave could not be free except for a loophole. They had a roundabout way for slaves to become free. See, here's what they believed. They believed that a god such as Apollos or Ares could purchase a slave. So here's how a slave would go about becoming free. Very few of them could actually do this. A slave would have to provide the money to purchase their freedom. This was not an easy thing for them to do, to be able to acquire the resources to do this. But just because they may have saved money did not mean that they could actually purchase their freedom, because a slave had no legal standing, which meant that they couldn't purchase their own freedom. So they had to give the money to their slave master, who would then go to the local temple where they would donate the money to the treasury on the slave's behalf. Now, when they did that, the slave was issued a piece of paper, a document that had these two words on it: for freedom, eleutheria. When they received this paper, it was issuing their freedom. It was their declaration of independence, their declaration of emancipation. And so because they had been purchased by a god, and I put that in air quotes because this is not the true god, this was a false god, but because they believed that a god purchased their freedom, nobody could ever enslave them again. So when Paul says it is for freedom, they're going, wait a second. All my life, I've longed to have a document stating that I could be free. So there's tremendous power in this passage. It says, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. This idea, stand firm. Stand firm. Paul's using a military term here. He's saying, I want you to picture the Roman guards here for just a moment. I want you to stand firm. I want you to resist. Don't cave into the pressure. Don't flee in fear. I want you to get this imagery in your mind. Imagine a bunch of guards digging their heels into the ground, interlocking their shields, banding together, saying, "You, whatever you got, bring it on, because we're not going to budge." That's the picture that Paul is saying. He's saying, listen, you stand firm and don't you dare let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Now, there's several images we get when we hear the word yoke. One, we think of this wooden harness that goes on an oxen as it plows a field. That is a yoke. But another definition of the word yoke in their day, in their time, would be called a rabbi's teaching. Or a, you know, somebody's philosophy of teaching. And so what Paul is saying is, you have been placed under a yoke. These Judaizers, these legalists, have been placing their yoke upon you, their teaching upon you, and it is causing slavery and bondage. Matter of fact, Jesus one time said, "My yoke is easy and my burden is light." Total opposite of what these guys are hearing from the Judaizers that are trying to put them in bondage. So he says, stand firm. Don't let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. And then he continues on in verse 2. He says this. He says, mark my words. Pay attention to what I'm about to say. I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourselves be circumcised. So they've been listening and they've been drifting, but they have not taken the plunge. He says, if you let yourselves be circumcised, Christ will be of no value to you at all. And then he says this, again, I declare to you, in case you missed it before, I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is obligated to obey the whole law. So these young churches, these new believers, these non-believers, these that are interested in Paul's teaching are drifting away from the message of grace, the gift of grace that Paul has preached to them. They've been deceived into believing that their standing with God is solely based on obeying the law, following the rules. And if they follow the rules good enough, then they're in right standing with God. And the reason Paul seems to be making such a big deal about circumcision is that circumcision was the initiation into believing and living according to the law. So once you were circumcised, you were saying, my trust is in the law. I believe the law has the power to save me. And so once you do that, you are obligating yourself, indebting yourself to all 613 articles of the law. And keep in mind, if you break one of them, you are guilty of breaking all of them. So the idea here is that these young churches are standing at a fork in the road. And Paul's saying, listen, you have a decision that you've got to make. You can go this way, and you can choose circumcision, and you can choose law, and you can choose works, and you can choose performance, or you can go this way, and you can choose Christ, and you can choose grace, and you can choose faith, and you can choose the promise of God, but you can't travel both. You have got to make a decision. Is it going to be about trusting Jesus or trying to keep the law? You see, to go down the path of circumcision or the path of the law says, I do not believe that what Jesus did on the cross was enough. And so I'm going to earn my own salvation. And so I've got a decision to make. And I would say, church, we all are standing at a crossroads at some point in our life. Some of you have made the decision. Some of you have not. Some of you today is going to be the decision-making day. And you've got to choose, am I gonna live for self? Am I going to try to earn this on my own? Or am I going to trust what Jesus did? And so when we look at this passage, every indication was that these young churches were leaning towards law over grace, works over faith, a legal system over a living Savior. And Paul's saying, listen, I can't bring this strong enough. I can't stress this enough. There's some serious implications in choosing law over grace. Let me show you these. He goes to it in verse 4. He says, you who are trying to be justified by the law. Now, justified means made right. Those of you that are trying to be made right by the law have been alienated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace. Listen to this here. Alienated from Christ, fallen away from grace. These are some strong words. Here's what Paul is saying. Paul's saying, if you choose law over grace, you haven't lost your salvation. You never had it to begin with. See, a lot of times in the church world, there's this question of, can I lose my salvation if I do some bad things, if I sin, have I lost what I had? No, your salvation is kept in Christ. Your salvation is established when you put your faith and trust in what Jesus did and Jesus alone. They're standing at a crossroads where they're not sure if their trust is in Christ or if their trust is in themselves. And he says, if you get circumcised and you go down this path, you are declaring your allegiance to the law. You are cutting yourself off from Jesus Christ. This is an intentional decision. This is an intention. I mean, nobody, think about this, nobody accidentally gets circumcised. Can we agree on that? Without getting too graphic, none of us were like, oh my goodness, how did this happen? Okay, that is not an accident. That is something that is intentional. And to go down the path of circumcision and law says, I'm going to save myself. My faith is in myself. My hope is in my ability. I am cutting myself off from grace. And think about this. If circumcision could save you, if the law could save you, if works could save you, then Jesus died for nothing. And we know that there was purpose, that Jesus died for a purpose, that Jesus died for our sins, that he died for our salvation. He didn't die for nothing. And then Paul continues on in verse 6. Look at this. He says, for in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. Here's what he's saying. Doesn't matter if you are Jewish or if you're Greek. I don't care. God's not concerned if you're Jewish. God's not concerned if you're Greek. He says the only thing that counts is what? Say this with me. It is faith expressing itself through love. The only thing that matters, it doesn't matter where you were born. It doesn't matter the color of your skin. It doesn't matter your income. It doesn't matter if you're male or female. The only thing that matters is faith expressing itself through love. See, Judaizers believe, these legalists that were deceiving these young churches believe that the mark of those that are saved is circumcision. And Paul is saying, no. The mark of the saved is not circumcision. The mark of the saved is love. It's love. He's saying you don't need the law when you have love. Love fulfills the law. See, the law says don't murder. Don't steal. Don't sleep with someone else's spouse. Don't sleep with somebody you're not married to. Don't lie. Don't covet. The law is like, don't. Here's limits. Don't wear this. Don't dress like that. Don't listen to this. Don't go to that. The law is all of these don'ts. Love flips the law upside down. Love looks for ways to bless others. Love looks for ways to give generously, to speak encouragement. Love says if you see a neighbor in need, help them. If they're sick, care for them. If they forget to take their trash can to the street, you go take it to the street. Love says, I'm going to do everything I can to be a blessing to other people. We're not obligated to this system and this legal system of the law as described here in the Judaizers' way of teaching, their yoke. We're saying, I'm choosing to live by the law of love, by the gift of grace. It supersedes all of the law. And so Paul says, listen, don't go down this path, because all it's going to do is end in frustration, pride, discouragement, defeat, and failure. He says, you were designed to live free. Let me show you what this looks like. And he does this in verse 13. Verse 13, he says this. He says, you, my brothers and sisters, listen to just his tone. His tone here again, he's calling them family. I care deeply about you. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. The one who created you to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge in the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly. And look at what he says. He says, for the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. Love your neighbor as yourself. He says, don't use this freedom for you to do whatever you want. It's not about doing whatever you want. Some of us have this idea, well, I'm free, I do what I want. I do whatever I want. You can tell me what to do, I'm gonna do whatever I want. You know what? When we take the freedom that we have in Christ to do whatever we want, we actually wind up in bondage to the things that we wanted to do. You know anybody like that? Oh, I'm free to do this, you can't tell me. And all of a sudden, the things we think we're free to do end up putting us in bondage. Paul's like, don't go down that road. Don't go down that road. He says, listen, don't use your freedom to indulge in the flesh. What does he mean, the flesh? The flesh. He's talking about our selfishness. He's talking about our sin nature that all of us are born with. He says, don't go down this road. Here's what he's saying. I want you to see this. He says, I am not free to sin. I have been freed from sin. You who are called to live free, and by the way, that's every single one of you. When God created you, he did not create you to live under the burden of slavery and obligation to a system and a law. He created you to live free. I am not free to sin. I am free from sin. Saying sin is no longer my master. It doesn't have that grip on my life. See, some people think that Jesus has freed them to do whatever they want. No. Jesus freed you to live above the law, to lay down the law. I've titled this message, Laying Down the Law. Look at your neighbor and say, lay down the law. Lay down the law. You know, as a parent, sometimes you got to lay down the law, and that's where you lay down the law in your house. But Paul's saying, I'm letting you lay down, drop it, and go on. God's got a better way. Lay down the law. And so Paul says, listen, don't make yourself a slave because of things that you think. You can go do whatever you want. That's what these guys were beginning to believe. Oh, well, I'm free. I can do whatever. No. You are not free to sin. You've been freed from sin. Paul says, don't use your freedoms for selfish purposes. Use your freedoms to serve others. And then he begins to recap some of what Jesus said. He said, the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Can I let you in on a secret? Those of you that are in a relationship, especially those that are in a dating relationship, can I let you in on a secret? Here's a secret. If you want to know if somebody really loves you, because people will say they love you and they don't really love you. They may love spending time with you. They may be infatuated with you. They may think you are smoking hot, and therefore if they say they love you, then they may get something from you. Let me tell you how you know if somebody truly loves you. If someone really loves you, they serve you. If somebody is unwilling to serve you, it is because they don't love you, because love demonstrates itself through serving. And if we are going to live a life of love, then servanthood and serving is going to be the natural byproduct of it. So in my relationship, I can tell my wife all day long, baby, I love you. I love you. I'm so blessed by you. But you know what that begins to sound like in her ears? Wah, 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 wah. Like, show me. Show me. And when I begin to serve, when I begin to speak my wife's love language, she knows that I love her. And some of you are in a dating relationship and the person you're dating has not served you ever. It's because they don't love you. I'm just letting you in on a secret. I know that may end the relationship. You can thank me later. I'm saving you some heartache. But here's what Paul's saying. He's saying, don't use your freedoms. to be selfish. Use your freedoms. You are free to serve other people. I'm not free to sin. I've been freed from sin. Now, I want to show you kind of what this looks like. I remember when I was in college, and I had a professor that began to break this down. He said, listen, I want you to understand, all of us, all right, I'm going to draw here, so don't be hating on my artwork, but he said, so this is us, all right? So here you are. All right, so that's you. All of us are born into a world that is broken, okay? Because of Adam and Eve sinning in the Garden of Eden, every single person is born into a world that's broken. It's why there's so much hurt. It's why there's so much brokenness. It's why there's sickness. Every nastiness, every brokenness, every awful thing in our world is traced back to what happened in the Garden of Eden when people chose to disobey God. So when you and I are born as a little baby, cute as we are, we have a sin nature. So there is this nature the Bible calls our flesh. We are born with this. So here's you and me, all right? That's us. And when we are born into this world, we are born with a flesh nature, a sin nature, a selfish nature. And here's the thing, this flesh is the driving force of our life. And so if this is us, this flesh is functioning as the driving component in our life. And so in this life, there's things that we find ourselves doing that are selfish. So we'll find, you know, selfishness. Why is it that one of the first words kids learn is mine? Because that's our flesh. That's our sin nature. That's the way that we're wired. Why is it that when somebody tells us not to do something, we want to do it? It's our sin nature. It just comes natural to us. But along with this flesh comes this idea that if I'm going to be right with God, it's going to come by trying harder. This is where we start telling ourselves, if I can just follow the law and do enough, then I'm going to be made right. And so what happens is we see religious systems created on this idea of trying to obey laws. And so this is where we get like religion. Religion says we are made right with God by what we do, by how we live. And all of a sudden, Paul is trying to help these young churches understand this is default for all of us. I mean, every single person here, this is default. We are driven by our flesh, by our sin nature. This has caused separation between us and God, but God, in his love and his grace, sent his son Jesus to create another way. Another way. So all of us are born this way, but we don't have to live this way. Here's what the Bible tells us. The Bible says that we can live by the flesh or we can live by the Spirit. When you and I come to the place where we discover that what Jesus did on the cross, he did for us, then what happens is we are now born of the Spirit. That's why the Bible says, you can see this in John chapter 3 and verse 6, when Jesus is talking to Nicodemus, he says, you must be born again. That's where this idea comes from. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is Spirit. And so when we come to the place where we put our faith and trust in Jesus, we are born of the Spirit. And what that means is we now have a second nature, a new nature going on inside of us. And this Spirit is trying to lead and control and guide our life. And that's a good thing. And I just realized we're not smiling. Now that we have the Holy Spirit, we're smiling, okay? So there's joy and there's happiness in our life. And so here's what goes on. So the Spirit is the opposite of all of this that the flesh creates. The Spirit says it's not about trying, it's about trusting what has already been done. It's not about law, it's about the gift of grace. The Spirit says it is not about being selfish, it is being selfless. Keep in mind, we are free to serve other people now. It is not about religion, it is about a relationship with Jesus Christ, a relationship with our Heavenly Father. And so the question becomes, which of these becomes the driving force of our life? All of us have this flesh nature trying to tell us what to do, but we've got this Spirit, the Holy Spirit, who lives in us and takes up residence when we put our faith and trust in Jesus. Let me tell you this. I don't know if you know this, but the moment you put your faith and trust in Jesus, the moment you stood at that crossroad and said, I choose Christ, I'm not trusting in my own efforts, I'm not trusting in my works, I'm trusting in the work of Jesus on the cross. His death, his burial, his resurrection was enough for me. You receive the Holy Spirit. So the question that you and I have got to figure out and we've got to wrestle with is which of these natures is going to be the driving force in our life? Which one are we going to let to be the dominant factor in how we live our life? Many of us, our life to this point has been the byproduct of allowing flesh to be the driving force in our life. But before I paint the picture that the flesh is just kind of produces this ugly behavior, let me warn you, the flesh, self, is tricky. There's a quote that I read as I was studying for this message, incredible book. It's called Exploring Galatians. It's a commentary on the whole book by John Phillips. He says this. He says that the flesh is not allowed to indulge its repulsive side. It will indulge its religious side. It will dress up in its Sunday best and go to church. It will walk the aisle, submit to baptism, sing in the choir, teach a Sunday school class, and indulge in good works. It will sing, pray, and take communion. There is nothing the flesh will not do. Emphasis here on the word do. Watch this. It is a great doer. It will persuade us that all of this doing is just what God wants. It is just another way of putting us under the law. See, the flesh, if it can't make us repulsive, it will make us religious so that we begin to believe that it is our doing rather than what Christ has already done. That's why Paul is so emphatic. And in verse 16, he says this, "So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They're in conflict, they're in battle with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you're led by the Spirit," listen to this, "you are not under the law." Paul's saying there's this constant battle going inside. There's your flesh nature. There's your spirit nature trying to lead us and trying to control us. And Paul says, listen, you've got to make a decision because each of these have byproducts that come to play in our life. And then he begins to show us, verse 19. He says, let me tell you, you want to live by the flesh? Let me tell you where that leads you. Check this out. Here's the byproduct of the flesh. The acts of the flesh, or you could say the fruit of living to the flesh, are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions. I mean, this is a great list, isn't it? Envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. And he says, I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. Those that choose to live for self, we're going to see these fruits begin to demonstrate in our life. And because we've chosen to do this on our own apart from Christ, we're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. But he says, that's not the only option. Remember, you're at a fork in the road. I want you to lay down the law because I got something so much better for you to pick up. He says, listen, you don't have to live this way. Look at verse 22. He says, but, somebody say, but. This is a big but. I love it when I come across a big but in Scripture. It's saying you could go this way, but there's another option. Check this out. You want to live by the Spirit. We were designed to live by the Holy Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. I mean, isn't this the things that we want in our life? These are the things that we desire. And then he says, look, against such things, there is no law. There is no law. When you live by the Holy Spirit, you don't even have to worry about the law. See, the flesh says, all right, where's the line? How far can I go? What can I get away with? The Holy Spirit says, no. Why do we want to think that way? How do we love people? How do we serve people? Let's be patient. Let's be kind. And the Holy Spirit begins to produce these things in our life. The law produces all this ugliness. The Holy Spirit begins to produce all this goodness, love, joy, peace, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. So the question is, I've got these two natures, and I know that you know this because you've wrestled with this. If you have a relationship with Jesus, you know the tension. You know the wrestling. How do I make the decision to say, I want to live by the Holy Spirit? How do I develop this fruit? Well, first, you and I don't develop it. The Holy Spirit develops the fruit in us. But how do we see this become a part of our life? Here's what Paul says. He says, let me tell you. I'm glad you asked. Let me tell you, verse 24. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. He says, you want to know how you see this become a part of your life? Here's how. Here's how. We begin to make the decision that I'm going to live for the Holy Spirit. He's the guiding force, the guiding principle. I was designed to be in a relationship with God. I was designed to have the Holy Spirit as the driving factor in my life. And so he says, look, if you belong to Christ, meaning you've made the decision, I'm choosing Christ. I'm not doing circumcision thing. Now listen, in our day and age, let me make this clear. Circumcision is something, it's a medical thing. It's different, okay? Can we just, some of you are like, uh-oh. No, no, you're okay, all right? Just be clear about that. I don't want any confusion. It is a decision to live by a legal system rather than a living Savior. And so saying, I've made the decision, Jesus Christ is the Lord and Savior of my life. Then what has happened is that we have made the decision that our flesh has been crucified. That's pretty gory imagery there. Our flesh is crucified. And if you think about this, it is physically impossible to crucify yourself. Think about that. It is physically impossible to crucify ourselves. We crucify our flesh when we put our faith in what Jesus did on the cross. His death, his burial, his resurrection. And when you trust that Jesus is enough, that's when your flesh loses power. And you're saying, I'm going to live by the Spirit. And here's what Paul tells us. He gives us two things. I close with these two things. He says, listen, you want to live by the Spirit? You want to experience freedom? You want to lay down the law and take up life? Here it is. Number one, put all your trust in Jesus. Put all your trust. There's a lot of people that put some of their trust in Jesus. Well, I just don't know about this Jesus thing, but just in case, I want to put a little bit of trust there. So it's like a little bit of trust in my own efforts. Hope I did enough. Hope I'm good enough. Hope I went to church enough. Hope I gave enough. And Jesus. No, no, no. It's not Jesus and. It is just Jesus. Put all your trust in Jesus. When I put all my trust in Jesus, what I'm saying is that I am living for him. He's my Lord. He's my Savior. He paid my penalty for freedom. I have received a document saying that my life is now set free because of Jesus. So first thing is put all your trust in Jesus. The second is this. Follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. Follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. If you've ever had a moment when you put your faith and trust in Jesus, the Holy Spirit lives in you. And you know this because there's times where you feel conviction over something that you've done. And that's something that you never thought twice about before. But now something just doesn't sit well. Or maybe you've been tempted to make a decision that you knew wasn't right, but something inside of you said, there's a better way. Don't do that. Don't do, and you're like, where does that come from? That's the Holy Spirit. He comforts us and he guides us and he convicts us. So we put all our trust in Jesus. It is only Jesus, always Jesus, ever Jesus. And we follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. We keep in step, Paul says, keep in step with the Holy Spirit. Step by step, right? Step by step. Any new Kids on the Block fans? Step, okay. So step by step, we keep in step with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit leads us. He doesn't force. He doesn't twist your arm. He doesn't coerce. He encourages and he convicts. He cautions us. He corrects us. He doesn't guilt us. He leads us one step at a time. Every day, every hour, every moment. God, how do you want me to respond to this situation? Somebody blows up at us. God, how do you want me to respond in this situation? You hear at LifePoint so often, you hear us say, what's your next step? What's your next step? God is leading all of us in a next step as we grow in our walk with him. And so you hear us say, what's your next step? Because the Holy Spirit is always wanting to lead us to a closer relationship with Jesus. None of us have arrived. None of us are perfect. And so there's always a next step. So today, let me ask you, what's your next step? Have you been allowing the flesh to be the driving force, or are you allowing the Holy Spirit to lead you in your following? You know, there's this old Cherokee proverb about a grandfather talking to his grandson. And he tells his grandson, he says, there's a battle that goes on inside all people. And he says, my son, the battle is between two wolves. There's two wolves inside every person. This is what he says. He says, one is evil. It's anger, envy, jealousy, sorrow, regret, greed, arrogance, self-pity, guilt, resentment, inferiority, lies, false pride, superiority, ego. There's this wolf that is evil inside of us. And then he says the other is good. It's good. It's joy, peace, love, hope, serenity, humility, kindness, benevolence, empathy, generosity, truth, compassion, and faith. And the grandson thought about for a minute and said, "Granddad, which wolf wins?" And here's his response. He said, "The one that you feed is the one that wins." Sounds interesting, huh? The one that you feed is the one that wins. Now, go back to the illustration that I drew here on the TV, that we've got this flesh and this self and this sin nature, and we've got the Holy Spirit wanting to lead us and guide us. The one that we feed is the one that will lead. We live for self, guess what? We're going to be driven by that. We live for the Holy Spirit. We allow His leading, His guiding. We let love be the mark of our life, and we find that there's more joy and peace and purpose and the freedom that God has created us to lead. My question that I leave you with is, will you feed self, or will you feed and follow the Holy Spirit? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the love and the joy that you give. Father, I pray that you would allow us to live in response and obedience to your Holy Spirit. You are good, God, and we're so thankful for you. Just in this moment, church, with heads bowed and eyes closed, I just want to give you a moment. Maybe today you realize I've been living for self. There's never been a moment that I surrendered my life to Jesus. I'm standing at a crossroad. All of us have a decision to make. Some of us, we put off making the decision. Listen, to put off making the decision is to make the decision. To say, I'm not ready to put my faith and trust in Jesus, is to tell Jesus no. And you have a decision to make today. Today, if you've never made a decision to live for Jesus, let me just encourage you. Let me encourage you. God loves you more than you could ever comprehend. He loves you so much, the Bible says that he sent Jesus to go to the cross, to take your place, to take your punishment and your sin so that you can find freedom, so that you can find forgiveness, so that you can find salvation. And so I just want you to know that in this place, with heads bowed and eyes closed, I want you to know that you're loved by God. I don't know if anybody's ever told you that, but God loves you just as you are. But he loves you too much to leave you that way. He says, I love you so much, I'm going to send my own son to pay the debt that you could never pay. Don't believe the lie that you can be good enough and earn this yourself. You can't. The only way any of us receive forgiveness is by opening our hands, opening our hearts and our life, and receiving the gift of grace in the form of Jesus. And so if today you want to say, I want to receive that gift. I want to be forgiven. I want to have the Holy Spirit live inside of me. I want to be able to live in a way that is in relationship with God and honors him. I want to give you a chance to do that. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, just in this moment, would you make this your prayer from your heart to the very heart of God? Would you say, dear God, you can just repeat this in the quietness of your heart. Say, dear God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for giving me your son as a gift of grace. I put all my trust in Jesus, and I ask you today to forgive me of my sins, change my life, fill me with your Holy Spirit. I choose you. I choose life. Use me to show love to other people. Say this. Say, thank you for saving me. Tell them that. Thank you for saving me. Here's what I'd love to do. With heads bowed for just one more moment, for those of you that are here and you said, you know what, I just prayed that prayer. Listen, I want to celebrate with you, and I want to encourage you, and I want you to have a moment right now where you say, I just asked Jesus in my life. It's between you and the Lord. But here's the thing. When we walk out these doors, we live out a public profession of faith. We're not ashamed of the decision that we make. Jesus was not ashamed of you when he hung on the cross. We don't live ashamed of him. And I want you to have a moment right here, right now, where you say, that was me. I just asked Jesus in my life. So here's what we're going to do. With heads bowed and eyes closed, when I count to three, when I hit three, I want you to shoot your hand up high right where you are, and then we're going to celebrate together. So if that's you on the count of three, I want you to put your hand up high. Ready? On three, join me by raising your hand. One, two, three. Go ahead and put it up right now, right where you are. Right where you are. Just put your hand up saying, that's me. That's me. I'm putting my faith and my trust in Jesus. I'm not ashamed. Anybody else? Right now saying, that's me. That's me. Come on, church. Can we put our hands together? Let's celebrate together. Brothers and sisters, friends, family, thank you, Jesus, for what you've done in this place. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.